Hi everybody, welcome back to CMN 201. This is for our class for Wednesday, the 7th of April. So first of all, I wanted to apologize that I was not able to post a video for last class, but I had some technical difficulties and I hope that the video that I did post from a previous semester gave you an idea about some of the important pieces that I would have covered if I had been able to record for us. Where we are is talking about The Exorcist for this particular class and also getting ready for Halloween. And I wanted to talk a little bit also about the final project, which will be due at the ending of the semester. So I'm hoping that you've been giving some thought as to what you might be focusing on for your particular final project. And also to remind you that registration is now underway for both the summer and the fall semester. And as you know, things are still in flux, but at least in terms of what we think GCC will be doing is that in the fall, we will be offering different kinds of modalities or different courses that you could choose from in terms of whether it be online or it be in person or it be hybrid, which is a combination of the two. And of course, if things change with world events, that could also change as well. The summer schedule is out and many of the summer classes have yet to be staffed, but I can at least tell you which summer classes I will be teaching. In summer session one, I will be teaching English 247, which is a women in lit class. And in summer session two, I will be teaching a PCS 101, which happens to be a public speaking, and also a CMN 153, the media and popular culture class that is the overview class before this particular specialized class, and that focuses on horror film. And you don't need to necessarily take them in any kind of order. But if you're interested in media and popular culture, that's an option for you. And all three classes are being offered entirely online. So in terms of where we are with The Exorcist, I wanted to make sure that there weren't any problems with the link that I had given you. I've heard from one student in class, but only one student in class, saying that there was some difficulty with that particular link and that they were getting some unwanted spam and images. So if that's the case and you experienced the same, please let me know. It's been a little bit more challenging finding some of the more contemporary films available for free online. However, I was able to find Halloween because it's considered to be such a significant film, actually, in the Internet Archive. But going back to The Exorcist, one of the reasons why I wanted to show that particular film is because it was such a blockbuster and it led to such mass hysteria, and I gave several clips for you to view last class to get an idea of what was happening. I mean, literally, when we say that it was a blockbuster, what we mean is that people were standing for blocks waiting to be able, or multiple blocks waiting to be able to gain admittance to be able to see the film. And there were all kinds of police reports about individuals who experienced episodes either during or after the watching of the film. In fact, there's even one story where one of the viewers actually attacked the screen in an attempt to kill the demon, Pazuzu. Now, the fact that the 1970s were such a complex time probably had something to do with that. And also the fact that there were lots of subliminal elements that were in that film that were meant to disorient. And while most people are familiar with the iconic musical score, which is Tubular Bells, which a little piece of trivia that also happens to be the ringtone for my cell phone. But there are images that are embedded in there. Some can be captured by the naked eye and some that cannot, of the demon Pazuzu. There were also audio subliminal effects, pigs being slaughtered, for instance. And all of those lead to the sense of disorientation that the viewers felt when viewing that particular film. It was also a time in the 1970s when the drug culture was beginning to explode. So if somebody saw that film in an altered state And also, probably one of the reasons why that film led to the kind of hysteria that it did was because of the way that it dealt with Christianity and the way that it dealt with the devil. The idea that this film could touch on the heart of elemental evil. And it was based on a best-selling novel, a New York Times best-selling novel by William Peter Blatty. And it's loosely based on documented exorcisms. And there are exorcisms that go all the way back to biblical times. The film, and also I think the book, focuses on what Stephen King calls the gross out. That basically Regan McNeil as a possessed child. And again, that was probably one of the reasons why the film led to such hysteria, because no one ever expected to see these kind of images on screen, especially with a young child and especially with a young female child. There were all kinds of violations of taboos, as you would have seen when you saw the film. And actually, originally, it was given an X rating in Boston because of many of those images. Ironically, though, the film was actually edited, and there were two scenes that were deleted. One in particular, because it was thought to be too grotesque for the audience at the time, and that was called the spider walk scene. Now, if you saw the version that I had included in the link, it wouldn't have been the version that movie audiences saw in the 1970s. The version that the movie audiences saw in the 1970s would have been the edited version. The version that I was able to find online for free is the uncut version that gives about 15 additional minutes of footage, which includes the spider walk scene, which is basically the possessed girl, Regan McNeil, who's walking backwards on a staircase. They hired a contortionist to be able to do something like that. She's actually crawling backwards on a staircase, and she basically vomits about when she gets to the ending of the staircase. And I'm not quite sure why that scene was considered to be horrific when other scenes remained in the film, particularly scenes that involve the little girl and the crucifix. But nevertheless, that's usually what people focus on when they're talking about The Exorcist. But the real focus of both the book and the film is not the little girl. It is on the exorcists themselves, hence the title, The Exorcist. So I've always felt that this book and this film have been misread. That the real focus is on Father Karras and also Father Marin. And both of these individuals have inner demons. You get more of a sense of the inner demon for Father Marin in the extended version of the film and also more in the actual novel itself. But both of these individuals can be tormented, and they are, by the demon Pazuzu, and the hero is ultimately Christianity. So the Catholic Church actually found this film to be reaffirming in that it helped to establish the doctrine that good could conquer evil. Perhaps also one of the reasons why this film was considered to be so shocking for its time is that it presented priests as real individuals, people with problems, people who were drinking, people who were smoking. And in fact, if you think about all of the major characters in this film, they all have their own inner demons. So if you wanted to read this from a psychological perspective, they're all haunted, or they are all, in one way or another, possessed with the demons of their past. For Chris, and notice how close her name is to Christ, at this point she is an atheist, so she's given up the Christ, which perhaps is illustrated by the truncated name that she has of Chris rather than Christ. Her inner demons are about the privilege that she has and the guilt that she feels, specifically the idea that she's gone through a divorce, and at the time of the 1970s, that would have been seen as somewhat scandalous. And basically, the idea that her daughter is not getting the nurturing and the care that she needs and wants. And I think that's very well illustrated in the film when we see Chris McNeil and Regan McNeil sort of planning something for her birthday. And she's got, Regan McNeil, that is, has a copy of a fan magazine of her mother underneath her pillow, sort of illustrating how much she's missing her mother and that connection with her. And basically, Chris McNeil is a very successful actress that also would have been somewhat unusual in the 70s, that she's a strong, financially independent woman. But think about what actors do for livings. They lie for a living. So if we want to think about one of the reasons or some of the reasons why this particular family might have been targeted, perhaps we could use that as a reason, as well as they're living near a church in Washington, D.C. And if you're going to find the seat of evil, perhaps one could say that Washington, D.C. is our modern seat of evil. Chris is an atheist, which again opens her up to the idea of evil. And there's even a Ouija board in the house, which is oftentimes used to communicate either on a subconscious level with others and oneself or with the spirit realm. Of course, this movie leads to lots of questions about whether what we are watching is physiological, psychological, supernatural, or some combination thereof. And the idea of the novel starting in Iraq, I think, is quite important as well, because there's lots of folklore and biblical associations with Iraq. It's usually been identified as the original seat of evil, where the Garden of Eden would have been located, and Adam and Eve would have been tempted by the devil. And ultimately, that is supposed to be one of the explanations as to why there will never be peace in the Middle East, and specifically in Iraq. And I know movie audiences said they were somewhat confused by that opening scene with Father Marin in Iraq. It's a little bit clearer if you actually read the text itself, but basically Father Marin is much like a Van Helsing figure in Dracula, and that this is a man of medicine and faith, but also is willing to accept other possibilities outside of scientific possibilities. So, in terms of Marin, he happens to be a great archaeologist as well as a man of the cloth. And when we think about Van Helsing, he was a great doctor, but also was willing to embrace supernatural and specifically Christian solutions for supernatural entities. So he's on an archaeological dig, and the assumption is that during that dig, they somehow unearth this image or this statue of Pazuzu, which is released into the world. And then, of course, the movie transitions over to Washington, D.C., which I would suggest could be perhaps a secondary seat of evil. And Georgetown University, which happens to be a Jesuit university. So the symbolism of the film, I think, it is quite deliberate. And then, of course, we move over to Chris and her relationship with her daughter. Know how isolated these characters really are. Although they come from wealth and privilege, they basically are alone. Particularly Regan McNeil, she has no friends. She's going to basically be spending her birthday with her mother because there really is nobody else in her life, and she's amusing herself with playing with a Ouija board in the basement, which perhaps again could leave her open to the possibility of evil. And we're also introduced to Burke Dennings, who serves as a little bit of comic relief, but he also is important in that he is haunted by his own inner demons, as we see that he is an alcoholic and is having difficulty controlling his alcoholism. It also is a possibility for some of Regan McNeil's behavior, in that at least in the 1970s, it would have seemed quite shocking that a young girl would have the kind of profane language that the possessed Regan McNeil does. However, she has been around Burke Dennings, and he has, shall we say, quite colorful language. So that could be a way that she could have picked up on it. And there also is, for Regan, a certain level of concern that Burke Dennings and her mother might be engaging in some sort of, or about to engage in some sort of a romantic relationship, which could lead to some inner hostility or anxiety on Reagan's part. And that's important because one of the possibilities for the events that occur are poltergeist or paranormal phenomenon. Now, a poltergeist is oftentimes associated with a young girl, and this is a manifestation usually thought to be of puberty and all of the angst associated with puberty, and that unconscious and subconscious hostilities are basically directed out and through the mind, paranormal events, in other words, the mind influencing objects in the physical world occur, such as the moving of furniture or the unusual sounds, rappings, for instance. So, and obviously we've got pieces of that, the flickerings of lights and so forth and so on. When you couple that, however, with the possibles physiological, and many people have said that that's really the true horror of the film, is to see how medieval really the medical establishment is and the horrors that Regan McNeil needs to undergo in terms of the medical testing, that's really much more horrific than any kind of possession that anybody could ever witness. And many audiences responded that way, in the sense that they were not able to watch many of the medical tests that Regan McNeil was subjected to. But whether it be physiological or it be paranormal, let's say poltergeist, or it be psychological, again, we've got a lonely little girl, or it be supernatural in the realm of a true entity, a true demon of Pazuzu. And if Pazuzu is indeed a supernatural entity, then the target, and this is something that you see in the extended cut version, when they put in a scene where Marin and Karis are talking about what is the point of possession. That wasn't included in the original film. And they discuss that the real point of possession is not to attack the possessed, but to attack the individuals who love the possessed, the individuals who are surrounding them, to torment them. And we could definitely say that everyone is certainly tormented by what's occurring to Regan, but the priests themselves, Father Marin, and especially Father Karis, not only experience her torment, but Karis might be the perfect subject for a entity such as Pazuzu, because this is a priest who's lost his faith. So what better catch, so to speak, if you're the devil, to not only get an innocent young girl, but better yet, a priest who has lost his faith. And Karis has quite a bit of guilt associated with his own mother and his inability to care for her, and how he's taken a vow of poverty to basically serve in the cloth, and that's meant that he hasn't been able to care for her properly. And notice the contrast between a character like Karis, and then when he goes to try to get approval from church authorities for an exorcism, the kind of wealth and privilege that is surrounding him in that particular arena. And in fact, I think this film very much is an examination of great privilege and great poverty. Great poverty exhibited by Karis' mother, and great privilege exhibited by the McNeils, and the kind of lifestyle that they live, a lifestyle that they gain, again, through lies. In many instances. So the evil of wealth and the evil of poverty, I think, is perhaps one of the major themes in this particular film. But as I indicated, the deleted scenes are the real purpose of possession is tormenting others. Faith is evidence, not necessarily in our belief system, but in our actions. And then that spider walk scene, which again would have been included in the uncut version. But I think that one of the reasons why the Exorcist is important from a media and popular culture class is less about the actual film itself and perhaps the commentary of the times. It's oftentimes been read as a commentary of the 1970s, where it's a time of great political and social turmoil. It was a time of Vietnam and the youth movement, the idea that the world was basically going to hell, that religion was no longer a center in individuals' lives. There's even the scene, very meta in many respects, in The Exorcist, where we've got Chris McNeil, who actually is filming in a movie, and it happens to be a campus protest. And she does say at one point, you know, we've got to work within the system. And that's part of what Father Karis struggles with, is that he knows that he wants to perform an exorcism, but he also has to work within the system of the church officials as well. But whether or not we see this as a commentary on the turmoil of the 70s and perhaps some of the fear that adults had of their own children and of youth culture in general, that in many respects, adults would say that youths under the influence of drugs and alcohol were acting as if they were, well, for lack of a better word, possessed. I think what's more interesting about The Exorcist is about the reaction of the viewers to that particular film. And this film has oftentimes been ranked in the top 10 of the most frightening films. I don't know necessarily if it could stand up to that with today's standards. Obviously, we are much less conservative than we would have been in the 1970s and used to much more graphic images. But I think that the film still holds up well, and the twisting head from Linda Blair is actually in the Smithsonian, so it's viewed as a cultural artifact. So sometimes it's less about the film and more about the reaction to the film itself. And I think we might find something very similar when we get to the 1990s and we get to the Blair Witch Project, which also led to a very interesting audience reaction. But one of the reasons why is because this was the early days of the internet, and the Blair Witch Project, as a kind of mockumentary, took advantage of the internet and the ability to be able to spread information to large groups of people. So much so that many individuals thought the Blair Witch Project was actually based on reality. And they had put up a website to, again, sort of illustrate the sense that there was indeed a Blair Witch. So it was incredibly clever from a marketing standpoint. Though we know that other individuals can be quite clever in terms of a marketing standpoint as well. In terms of Psycho, probably Alfred Hitchcock's most clever marketing technique was to ensure that no movie theater owners would allow entrance to audiences after the movie had started. So again, that led to an incredible amount of buzz of what's going on in this particular movie, that we can't gain entrance until, or we're not allowed to gain entrance once it's actually begun. But when we think about moving into the 1980s, I'm going to do a little bit of cheating here again. As you know, that with the 1960s, I cheated by giving not just Psycho, which I think was a great examination of the idea that no place is safe, and also the idea that mental health issues could be, in one way or another, the new horror of our society. But I wanted to also give Night of the Living Dead because of not only, again, its cultural impact on viewers, but the fact that we've got a central African-American male character who is the hero, which would have been unusual for the time period. And of course, he's brutally killed at the end, which would have been quite shocking to audiences. And the scene itself is quite shocking. It seems very much like a gritty documentary and brings back all kinds of uncomfortable images of some of the police brutality that would have been going on during the civil rights movement in the 1960s. And sadly, some of the more recent episodes that we have experienced in our contemporary times, leading to the question, would this hero Ben have been killed if he hadn't been African American? Was there some sort of a rush to judgment, the assumption that he was monstrosity? But as George Romero has said many times, the real monster in his film are not the zombies, it's the humans and the way that they interact with one another, or their inability to interact with one another in times of danger. At least with something like The Exorcist, we've got a quote happy ending in the sense that evil is vanquished. I don't know necessarily if we get something like that in either Psycho or in something like definitely Night of the Living Dead. But do note that The Exorcist is deliberately ambiguous, and many of the films that we've been watching have embedded elements of ambiguity within them, so that if you don't necessarily want to grasp onto a supernatural explanation, then perhaps you can have a more realistic explanation. Even Halloween has a slight level of ambiguity, which is the next film that we're going to be talking about. The thing is that the film came out in 1978, which is the same decade as The Exorcist. So in that way, I'm cheating. But the reason why I'm assigning Halloween is because it really led to the slasher movement of the 1980s. So while the film came out in 1978, I'm using it as an example of the decade, the 1980s, in the slasher movie. The director is John Carpenter, and he says he was quite influenced by Psycho. So when you're watching Halloween, you might want to watch specifically in ways that he may have been influenced by Psycho. And many times that film is read as a prelude to the 1980s and the conservative movement of Ronald Reagan, which we'll talk a little bit more about in depth when we start talking about Halloween itself. As I indicated, I was able to find that on the Internet Archive. And again, if you were having difficulties with the Exorcist link, please let me know. As we get, again, more contemporary, I might have to do a little bit more scrambling to be able to find free versions of the films. But if worse comes to worse, I can always work with you individually so that you can get access to a copy of the film if it turns out that I can't find a free version for everybody to watch. But in terms of Halloween, it's become iconic. All you need to do are just hum the first few bars of music, which, by the way, John Carpenter wrote as well. And in fact, John Carpenter studied at USC. So there is a kind of academic element to this film. There's a deliberate element to this film that we may not necessarily see in horror film. And it was made with a shoestring budget, and it was incredibly profitable. So that led, as I indicated, to the slasher movies of the 1980s, which we'll start talking about why it is that the slasher movement would have been so particularly interesting in the 1980s. But after you view Halloween, if you haven't already seen it, but of course, if you have, I'm indicating that you should watch it again from an academic perspective. And there were several chapters that were devoted to thinking about not just Halloween, and that would be Chapter 7, Shrinking Man from Nightmares, and also Chapter 15, Carpenter, but also from horror film, Chapter 3, 1974 to the present. It'll give a good background of what would have been happening, as well as Chapter 6 from Projected Fears about Halloween. So all of those readings can help inform your viewing of Halloween, whether it's a first viewing or an 18th viewing, whatever the situation may happen to be. But after you do view it for our particular class, your attendance question for Thursday, and that would be the 8th of April at 6 p.m., is why do you think Halloween was such a successful movie when it came out, when it was made for so little money? And actually, most of the money went to Donald Pleasance, who was an A-list actor at the time. And Jamie Lee Curtis was just beginning her career, so she really didn't have any kind of star status at that point. But whether you've seen Halloween or not, I'd be hard-pressed to think that you don't know necessarily who Michael Myers is. He's become one of these iconic figures in our society. And as I began, I want to end by having you consider the idea of your final project and to write about it in your journals, or perhaps to send me an email about some of your thoughts or ideas of how you'd like to proceed as we are nearing the ending of the semester. And I hope you are doing well. I am doing well. Enjoy Halloween. We will put some closing comments on The Exorcist next class if necessary, and then talk about Halloween and also the Blair Witch Project. So, and of course, our final project as well. So take care. Bye-bye.